Hello, this is Captain Poodle speaking. Are you ready to find love?
Yes, ahoy, matey.
Love.
Do-do-do-do.
Exciting and new. Go online. They're catfishing you.
Shocker.
Fiancé.
Soon you'll be flying to parts unknown.
90-day Beyoncé.
Marrying someone you only met on your phone.
Be they French or Chinese, a brand new K-1 visa's the key.
Ooh, the key to what, Poodle?
To love.
It's reality game. Let's love.
Hello. Picture it. Some guy goes in and talks to you in a bar, and yeah, there's a camera there. Did you ever think you were going to have to show up to a fucking tell-all on 90 Day Fiancé to talk about how some creepy-ass guy hit on you, a.k.a. what happens to attractive women on the daily?
Poor Deborah. Where'd they dig this bitch up from?
Well, she had to sign a release to be on
That's
camera
true.
At all. So they got her information. They do always act like the producers of 90 Days just searched and searched for this person. And you're like, well...
We were ever going to see her again because she was shown in this kind of behind the scenes thing. And I think it was a low blow to show that in a... She might have... They didn't make a big deal of it in production. Mm. And they made such a big deal out of it at the tell-all. Because it was important,
it was
obviously.
Important. Yeah.
Why wasn't it featured more? Why didn't they actually air that?
Sometimes I feel like because they want to save like juicy moments for the tell-all. Because they want to see Cleo's reaction to it for the first time.
So...
As Cleo said, I'm disassociating. So we all are.
That's my new... Y'all, Shaun was disassociating like a motherfucker.
That whole thing about when they're talking about Jasmine, Pink, anytime they got into deep
Shaun
sex...
I liked it when she used her auntie voice with David. when David's doing all this stuff with his hands, she's like, David! David Mitchell McClintock, your mother would not like you doing that, child.
Davidster.
It did feel like her auntie voice.
It did feel like her auntie voice. Y'all, this is B90.
We're in New York.
We are in New York City. This is B90. This is your tell-all. Part two, or part one.
End of the season.
We are in my hotel room in New York City. Looking at a beautiful view of Central Park right now. We're not in Jake's room because, well... I would just slide off the chair because it would have lube on it.
No, your room has a bigger setup this way. My room's actually bigger, but...
He has the fuck wall. So we're here.
And you have a chaise, and I only have a daddy chair.
You did, but you were you told you quickly separated the chaise so that there's also a fuck stool.
Yeah. It's a talent I have.
If you're on the intimate portrait, you're seeing a little bit of, we're very washed out. I love this light. It's too much light, but we look 20.
And we sound really rough.
Well, we have evidence of that, because what did you see our thing?
90 Day Fiancé pillow.
Yes, we got a 90 Day Fiancé pillow.
Actual pillow talk.
This is pillow talk.
Pillow biter
we
talk.
We should sit on the bed for that, but I don't want to
sit on the bed with you.
No.
No.
Against God's will. It is. Even Misha would say, she would probably say that anyway.
Nicola
would pray. So yes, we did go to the 90 Day Fiancé party last
10
night.
10-year anniversary / 10th season celebration.
Yes. Yeah. We've already, by the time you're hearing this episode, we would have already put out we're doing our own special episode of Our Night with the cast of 90 Day Fiancé. Yeah. That's what we're calling it. I like it.
Our Night. Boy, that branding is great.
What? You're the one that came our up with it.
I didn't say that.
You said it earlier.
I didn't brand it. I think I said our... our, but I didn't expect you to use that branding.
Well, don't talk then, and I won't listen to you.
Fine.
I'm just being supportive. So you've already heard that.
That's not for prime time.
It's on the public feed and on the RG Plus, but we've already told you all the sort of details. Since then, Jake is now betrothed to someone at TLC now.
Now Winter and I are texting. I actually do need to say this. I'll probably say this on the Thursday show. For some reason, I got stuck talking to Winter at the bar.
I love talking to her.
And she was drunk.
Oh. Yes. Yes.
And I told her I was drunk too, y'all.
Yes, you were. I wasn't sober either.
Like, I was, and part of the problem is we have certain cast members, Veronica, Jovi, who relish in bringing people drinks.
It's funny how couples would attract us. Jovi, like, immediately glommed onto you.
Yeah.
And Yar and I talked for a long time.
Yeah.
So, anyway, we'll talk about all this in the thing. If you want to hear it, it's in our special podcast episode called Our Night with the cast of 90 Day Fiancé.
That's terrible.
We had a great time with, we had a great time, too, with Mary Payne.
And we met... Should we mention this?
No. Well, we already have. We forget this is going to...
Oh, fuck that.
It's already aired. They already know who we met. You are hungover. I just want to shout out...
Don't let Jovi bring you a Sazerac, y'all.
Yeah.
I don't know what was in it.
You're feeling it. I want to get our podcast right because we were there with Mary Payne and Ingrid. Ingrid was there. And also Ashley Ray, who's TVISA with Ashley Ray.
Yes, TVISA.
Who we're planning on doing a collab whenever we have time. But she was there too. So it was great to have a little podcast.
We had a great time.
We had a wonderful time. It was, and hats off to TLC on such a great thing. And
we met Matt Sharp.
They know. They already heard it.
I know. But I'm just excited to talk about it.
Oh, yeah. We're very excited. So
I called him daddy.
Yeah, we did. We both did. We both did.
And he laughed. And I'm like, no, really. I call you daddy.
I think we needed to record the episode where we talk about the night before. Because you're going to talk about it now like they haven't heard it. But they've already heard all this.
Why don't you give me grace?
It feels like I'm silencing you. I don't mean
Why
to.
Why don't you give me grace?
It's just, you hate keeping secrets.
I just want to talk about my experience from our night with the cast of 90 Day Fiancé. God, that's one of the clunkiest. It actually hurts me to say the clunkiest thing possible.
We're going to have to do it tonight. Maybe I'll get a drink from the hotel and they'll bring it up and we'll just have a little hair of the dog. I could use a Bloody Mary about right now.
Oh, that does sound good.
You know who did well is y'all.
I need
Ingrid,
something
in my
stomach.
Ingrid, I think, got a little drunk. Mary Payne held it together.
She did.
She did.
She didn't get white girl wasted like she did.
Not the podcast. Mary Payne really held it together.
Ingrid was getting close to me at the end of the night, talking.
My screen went off on my computer. Y'all, I forgot my camera, but it's still recording because the green light's on.
That makes me nervous.
Well, how
will I know if I'm in the frame? How I know how I look
I guess I'll just get up and touch my screen every 10 minutes.
But is it not plugged in?
Well, no, it's plugged in, but I don't know how to make it stop. It just does that.
I think you
that.
Just keep it on the whole time.
Well, I did, but it's got a screensaver.
Fine. Here we go.
It stops at 10 minutes.
Do we have any announcements besides that? Y'all, Golden Bachelor out this weekend.
How did you like our episode?
Out Friday. Well, episode one is out.
Poodle's hungover. We might have to get that Bloody Mary before part two.
Fuck.
Thank goodness we ate dinner afterwards.
That was helpful.
Again, Mary Payne handled that well.
I always hate it when I eat when I'm drunk because I never eat successfully. And then I think that food was actually tasty.
Like you don't remember eating the food?
No. I do.
You did at one point. There was this really good ravioli we were eating, and
oh yeah,
and
I do remember that.
And you reached across and you took it aboard and you just shoved the whole thing in your mouth and went boom, boom, and then swallowed it.
Yeah, I don't usually. I drink, but I don't usually get drunk.
You haven't gotten drunk in a long time. I was pretty drunk.
Yeah, I was drunk. I blame certain members of the cast for bringing me more than one drink.
It was a beautiful venue. All right.
It was cute.
Okay.
There were hot waiters. Jesus.
It was.
New York waiters are the hottest fucking waiters in the world.
The guy in the white jacket with the dark hair.
Holy shit.
I know. I complimented this one
girl
on her dress.
He was a stunner.
I said, your dress is so pretty. She said, thank you. It's like, no, it's stunning. And your makeup was like, what do you do for TLC? And she said, I'm here. I'm a waitress. And I said, well, you look gorgeous. Can I get a drink?
I'm a waitress.
Wow. Y'all, it's Cocktober.
It's Cocktober, and you're getting hand tossed. Golden Bachelor. There will be more. I think we make the official announcement now. We are not doing Below Deck Med officially. I'm still watching. I've got it downloaded for the plane. I'm very excited.
Good.
Because I need to let you guys know what Big Sand is up to.
Yes, I think you were very excited to learn what her gateway drug was. I think that would please
you. Yeah, I got all hopped up on Quaaludes one time.
What are Quaaludes?
Quaaludes are, you've obviously never seen like Wolf of Wall Street, but
I have.
It kind of slows you down. Uh-huh. Yeah, it's...
what do you take them for? To feel good?
No, it's just, yeah, it's just like, it's like, they're almost like... It's a kind of mind-altering.
Ah.
Yeah. I've never taken them. I just like how Quaalude has two A's in it.
It's a cool word. I agree.
Quaalude.
So, yeah, you're getting hand-tossed. I think it's going to be a bi-curious.
I'm going to offer it.
That word.
Yes.
Love is Blind's wrapping up soon. We've got...
No, 2 more weeks.
Well, I meant like it's wrapping. Yes, we've got... The last episodes, and then episode 10 will air in a couple weeks.
We 5 through 7 just dropped this past weekend.
Yes.
And 8 and 9 drop next week, and then 10 the week of my birthday.
Oh, it is your birthday month. You found
it's on
out
a Friday
in the stars.
This year.
Poodle was born on the week of theater. Boy, that's this.
I need to see where you found that.
It's in this astrology book. It said my week was dancers and dreamers, which makes sense because I always know I'm not
a dancer.
No, I'm telling you. I know this, as Oprah says, what I know for sure. If I was enrolled in dance classes when I was a little child, I think I would be a professional ballet or tap dancer.
I've seen you lumber around the stage.
I never was trained. Never was trained. I think I would have, but again, my mom wouldn't put me in dance class because it was too much.
You have the bearing of Bluto.
No. My dance teacher at North Texas said I had some of the most gorgeous feet for points she's ever seen. I'm telling you, I was a dancer in my past life. I know it.
Yeah, they couldn't have
called Petey.
They probably didn't have enough for your shoulders. They couldn't find a little ballet costume big enough for it.
Probably. I was a female ballet dancer in my past life, by the way. Not a male, I can tell.
Yeah.
Probably Russian.
Anyway, thanks for that.
You're welcome.
So I think that's it announcement-wise, right? Anything else we needed to say? I feel like I'm missing something, but I'm hungover, so
we'll
I don't really fucking care.
Yeah.
On the second show.
Yeah, y'all, we're going to, before we start, trigger warning beginning, miscarriage, we're going to be talking about that.
How are we going to know how long the show's going here?
Well, we're not.
Maybe I can get my phone out.
Oh, well, I can look. No, there's a timer at the bottom of the screen.
But we won't know once the screen goes dark.
No, I'm going to keep touching it, get up and touch it every 10 minutes. So that way it won't go dark.
Okay.
So that's what we're doing. We're doing our best.
Y'all. Intimate Portrait, you're paying for this because we're doing our best.
We're tired.
Otherwise, we couldn't travel.
We're tired.
Ever.
People want to see us in New York and we don't have time to do anything. Okay.
Anyway, let's just jump
Shaun
into
Robinson
this.
Shaun was not at the tell-all or at the 10th anniversary party.
She was not.
I thought that was just a choice. She kind of represents the brand.
Yeah.
All that. She lives in New York, like, or at least I think she does.
I don't know where she lives.
Just seemed like she would be here.
Hmm. That's true. I didn't think about that.
I don't know. Missed opportunity. But
we're going to tell you on our, or you've already heard it, obviously.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And if haven't, go back and listen to it. Tell you who was all. I actually love talking to the TLC people the most
that
we met.
That was great.
And because I didn't have to worry about thinking I'd said something bad about them. Like when Liz was like right in front of me and I was like, hey, so how's it going?
That was with you. That was uncomfortable.
Yeah, I was like, what do I fucking say to you? I have nothing to say to you.
I think she was drunk already.
She was.
It helped.
She was. And so was Pred.
I never talked to him. Yeah. Just something. Anyway.
Yeah, I didn't talk to him.
Okay, so Shaun asked Violet, she says, our night,
y'all,
with the cast.
Just imagine that with me going. Just imagine me saying, "What the fuck do I say to Liz?"
Yeah, it's true. What do you say?
Anyway, Riolet.
We're wrapping this up. Thank God. You know they're not together right now, but so Shaun asks,
and he needs to understand what happened.
Needs to understand,
so I can process, and the whole show needs to stop, so Riley can understand. And have feelings. This man is exhausting.
He is. When he was, he really put the nail in the coffin when he was coming after Razvan. I was like, don't you come for him.
So y'all, we find out the cutaway was, is Violet pregnant with Riley's child? And trigger warning here, she says, it's difficult for me because I'm, she says, in only Violet's way, I am old and I am not in good health, but I could not keep the pregnancy. Mm-hmm. In other words, it sounds like nothing was spelled out specifically. It sounded like she had a miscarriage.
Yes.
And at that point, Misha and Jasmine just cry and Violet's almost like, she couldn't talk about it, so she immediately kind of loses it.
She does.
And
Misha cried this whole time.
She did.
She was always crying.
She kind of won the tell-all for me. Her and Jasmine.
Oh, Jasmine.
Jasmine for sure. Yeah. Misha had like good takes on a lot of people.
Okay, so I will say, because we didn't feel like we got this a lot. Does a tell-all cause resolution? Do we learn new things? We got that from more of this tell-all. Like some of the
this part.
Even Misha as a cast member, we'll talk about that, left kind of with a different perspective on this. So
then Riley's like, Riley, what do you think about that? He's like, well, until I understand everything, I can't emotionally attach to whatever happened. So, and I wrote down, can you have a lick of fucking empathy?
No.
Instead of this. This was where I'm like, oh, you haven't changed at all.
No, even Tiffany, who's your friend, became more understanding of Violet.
Y'all, there's no hope for this man to change and to be vulnerable and let someone else in his life. Come on.
No.
That's when I went, fuck you. Fuck you.
Because Shaun says, well, how do you feel hearing this? And he says, that's when he says, yeah, well, I'm just kind of like, he doesn't say anything like, I'm so sorry she went through that.
No.
I hate that I couldn't be there her.
It's all about him.
He was like, he started to say, but he didn't. But you could tell he was wanting to say. Well, I was kind of like,
Well, here's the thing.
Let me fix it.
Here's the thing. As soon as they're talking about that, Tiffany even says, well, as far as the timelines, who I finally figured out what this was, her outfit. This was Unitarian pastor realness.
Yes.
Yes. Like rainbow robe. Yes. Mm-hmm. And even when she left, was spoiler, she went, find love.
Yeah. Well, she was like, find love.
That was my favorite thing in the entire tell. Find love.
I kind of love her now. I kind of like love her.
Oh, come on. She's a star fucker. She's going to be on television.
But she's good. She's good. I hope we never see Riolet again.
Riley. Yeah, definitely. Well, the thing about it is, and I wrote down, and she's like, you know, as far as the timeline, 4 weeks later, I believe that it might have been yours talking to Riley. I'm like, are we really going to talk about this right now? Mm-hmm. That we're like, but here's the thing. What would it have mattered if it's even his child or not? This woman lost a child.
It is.
It's insensitive as fuck.
Well, Shaun pushed that too. So the producers pushed that too. I thought so. I think as soon as someone says they miscarried the baby, you should have just been like, well, okay.
We're going to have to leave that here.
We're going
to
leave that here.
Now that's where you use that phrase.
Or what's next?
Or like, this can't be solved today.
That's horribly sad. We're so sorry. We're, you know.
I felt disgusted.
It's,
It was just, it was, and like the fact that they were talking about the child's paternity. Mm. And I hated it. Anyway, right. And Violet said part of me wanted to tell him, but part of me didn't. In Vietnamese culture, we want our children to have a mother and father. And then finally, Jasmine says, well, you know what, Riley? You have not been that great to her.
No. No.
And Riley's like, well, I still have to understand. Why can no one make me understand? And then only then can I process and move on. You'll never understand.
You'll never understand.
You're fucking clueless.
And then that whole thing where he wants to...
Dumbass.
She's coming to the U.S. on a tourist visa and he wants to meet and break bread. I'm like, no, you don't.
He wants to interrogate her more.
You know what I think he wants? This whole thing with Rosvin, it's that you spot it, you got it. I think he wants to fuck her again.
Yep.
He wants to have sex. Y'all, boy. That's it.
He even made himself, if possible, he might have looked almost, not didn't go as bad as Christian.
No. Boy, didn't that make you feel good?
What?
How everyone just came for him. We're going to talk about
that. Of course, yeah.
Yeah.
So, and then Violet says, I feel much lighter now. And then Shaun goes, well, that was a lot to unpack. Riley, what's next for you?
Riley, what's next for you?
And that's when you talk about Violet's coming on a tourist visa. We're going to break bread. And if it's God's will. So now we bring God into it.
As soon as Riley says God's will, you see they always cut to Misha and Nicola going, They look like the audience members just sitting out there.
Photos. You cannot convince me otherwise.
They never show the audience with the cast. They remind me, what was that
thing? Stock photo of crying woman.
Yes, they looked very much like the audience in the, what was that thing? It was a dehydrator where you could dehydrate
the
meat.
The Ronco food dehydrator from Ron Popeil. Yeah. Oh. And we all know, what kind of chef dad is, right, audience? No. Dad can't cook.
The Ronco.
Clap, 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 applause. The Ronco food dehydrator. This audience was straight out of that. And what do? You said it and forget it.
I used to watch all those. I'm hot now.
There has never been a more useless audience.
Yeah,
this was such a dumb
idea.
You couldn't even hear them. I don't know what this was here for.
At least have an audience, maybe. Like, you never heard them react.
Yeah.
Like, you never heard when she said she had a miscarriage, the audience go, oh, they showed some people crying. But
I'm just picturing, and Violet, I couldn't keep the baby. Oh,
but still, something.
You should hear audience tremble. Oh.
Yeah,
you would hear that.
Yes,
I think they might have. I think that felt like that might have been a little too exploitive. No. But not more than asking what about the paternity of the baby when the baby's gone.
I mean, at least they could have booed Christian. At least they could have cut.
It turns into a puppet show.
When
all
they
of
show
a sudden.
The video of him talking to Deborah, they could have cut. They could have cut after they cut back to the tell all. You just see a woman
to a black woman going, no.
Looking at her friend.
Hell no.
That's what they needed.
Yeah.
Let's move on. Let's talk about Christian and Cleo, shall we?
Yes. And after Tiffany said, find love.
We'll talk about them and then we'll see where we are and we might break after them. We'll see.
Yes. Because
I wrote a lot for Christian.
Me
and Cleo.
Too. Y'all, she just left Minnesota 3 days ago.
3 days ago.
And she said, we were shacked up as he, in only the way that he can, He makes things. Everything is a performance.
Everything.
And I've talked about my theory about him before and why he's so resistant, because it's not just as easy to say he's a narcissist. It goes beyond that. My theory is, and I'll go into this later, it's a performative personality that he's created.
Mm-hmm.
That, and he doesn't even know.
Mm-hmm.
He is completely almost unaware.
It's some type of personality.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And I'll talk about where it came from. And I'm not trying to make him sound sympathetic, because I think he's a complete douche nozzle.
Oh.
But
at the end, when he said, "I think I came off, I was exonerated," I was like, oh, you didn't get this at all.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. He didn't get it at all. But I'm saying this, if you think about it, this explains it. Part of this explains why he believes it's more complex than simple narcissism.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I agree with that.
And so she just left Minnesota, and we were shacked up for a month.
She met all the women in his family.
And this is a question.
She said it was great. She felt very included. They were really supportive.
I thought this was self-explanatory, but I understand why Shaun had to ask it.
I'm glad she did.
It's like, what about, why not the men? And he said, well, the men in my family are very like masculine, conservative, and hurtful things were said. And I was trying to shield Cleo from that. That was like the best thing he did.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
And of course, Jane shows up, the friend, and they're like, well, how do you feel? And they're like, well, it's a tough one. Sometimes I think Christian is too selfish and he has a hard time hearing Cleo. That is definitely true.
That is true.
And y'all, the weirdest thing here is everything that Jane says, this is the tricky thing. Jane has now been Chantelled, or Christian has been Chantelled to Jane. So everything bad that happens, mm-hmm. she tells Jane.
Yes, 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 yes.
All, and then once they've hashed it out, quote unquote, mm-hmm. where Cleo accepts his flaws, she says, no, 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 but he's really good. It feels like abuse cycle.
Yes.
All over again.
Yeah.
And then Cleo said, well, we're on the verge of understanding each other better.
Because Christian says he's changing, and yeah. I don't know how.
And then Jane says, but he's still chatting with other girls. And Cleo goes, oh, my God. Like, she's annoyed that even saying it.
She does say, and what, something that comes up in this, and I'm glad that the cast members called him out on it. David keeps speaking for Cleo, Christian keeps speaking for Cleo the entire tell-all, and it's frustrating. Literally, she'll be asked a question, or in this case, she started to talk, and she's like, well, and then Christian jumps in and says, well, let me explain, because I don't think she wants to say. Let me mansplain for everyone.
Yeah. And it's weird, though. I don't think it comes from a place of, she doesn't know what she's talking about. It comes from a place of, I'm afraid she may go to pieces mm-hmm. if this happens. Like, I'm not defending him here. It's super specific
Actually,
for his reasoning.
Actually, I still think that's just as shitty.
I agree with you, but I'm seeing his motive behind it.
I think the motive is just as shitty, because the motive is saying, I need to show her that I'm her, that I take care of her, and that she needs me, instead of just letting her experience her own emotions.
Right. Totally agree.
Yeah.
But it's different than specific mansplaining, which is, you're dumb, you don't know what you're talking about.
It's actually, in a way, more, not insidious, but just more subtle and covert.
But his intention is very different.
Yeah.
On that
but
side.
I still think it's
but it still makes her feel unheard.
Yeah, it makes her feel unheard, but it's still the way, if he was just, she's a dummy and I've got to explain, both the things he's doing, I think, are about him feeling better about himself.
100%. So later on.
I mean, someone who starts a fucking group.
Oh, don't get me started. The Steiners. Boy, we learned, y'all, this is some incel shit. This is, and all these friends, I guarantee, these weren't the hot friends we saw, because those mm-hmm. were his server friends. Y'all, It sounds like I know for sure he's a server. I do. I promise you, either he worked in a bar or he was in a restaurant.
I bet you he worked at Molly Murphy's.
What's that?
Remember, wasn't that the one in Dallas? The restaurant, Poodle's Face.
What the fuck are you talking about?
I thought you were there. I remember some people in school would work there. Molly Murphy's, it's one of those restaurants where everybody like plays a different character and they treat you a certain way. Like you've got Betsy the Pirate, or you've got...
I hate that shit.
Or you've got Sebastian the Burglar or whatever. And they're...
Why would anyone want to go to a place like that?
I don't know. Or like, I've
heard like Ed DeBevick. Where they treat you like shit.
Yeah, like Tevi the cowboy, whatever. You got all these people that show up at the restaurant and they act a persona when they serve you food. And it's like you're...
I can't think of anything I would want less.
Y'all
right,
have a Molly
right
Murphy's.
Now, in this moment, there is nothing more. There's
the food was terrible.
There's no place that I would not rather be.
It's like a medieval times, but imagine medieval times... or the pirate place, which was started by the family of medieval times because they had a falling out. And so they left and said, fuck you. We're going to start a pirate restaurant.
What the fuck? How do you fucking know this?
But anyway, so that it's like, imagine the medieval times people came and served you food and were your waiter as well in character. That's what Molly Murphy's.
Don't they do that at medieval times?
Do they? I haven't been a long time.
The fact that they're like choosing a... We need to move on. I'm having lots of problems with this character driven.
Don't you think Christian would work at a place like that?
100%.
Like, he would love it.
So y'all, this whole Steiner thing, we're going to talk about that in a second. But she, he gets right to it. He's like, well, there was one instance, but well, we talked about it. And so Cleo says, Chris's like, we have this kind of group called like Steiner Anonymous. It's a Discord server. And this gal, he says, this gal joined in. She was kind of active. And Cleo's like, she was active with you. She made it clear that she found you attractive. And he's like, she called me cute. I like making friends. I cast a very wide net. God.
And one of the girls is that. Amanda, who, don't worry, y'all, she gets...
Holy shit!
She gets red for filth, too. It's great.
Well, I'd want to save this for the second show because it brought tears to my eyes how beautiful this was.
It was great. This was a good tell. Like Poodle said before we started, they saved all the good shit for this second
they
half.
This was chock full of nuts.
Yes.
Of beautiful nuts.
But Amanda does have some good, where Amanda said she was like, yeah, you just keep justifying your actions with excuses. And she said, do you even care that you hurt her? And Christian says, well, I regret it now because I hurt her. When Riley tells you, wrong answer, buddy, you're in some shit. You're walking the wrong path if Riley is telling you.
This is the thing. It's this, he literally, he can't see what he was doing was flirting because it's almost like a personality disorder. He has created this persona because y'all, this is an act. This isn't him. The actual Christian is probably not even that extroverted. This is something he's had to do because he's felt completely and utterly inadequate.
I agree with that, but it was gross watching this clip of him talking to
Deborah. Oh, it was disgusting.
Deborah. It was him hitting on her.
But what I'm saying is, I think this man watched, and you can tell, everything's performative even. It's not authentic at all. And it feels like he'd watched guys at a bar or watched guys on TV flirt with girls, mm-hmm. and that's the persona he adapted.
It's a bit of like... I don't think he is, but y'all, sociopaths mimic. That's the way they like kind of learn behavior.
I could see that more than narcissist.
Mm-hmm.
That's the thing.
It is how, but he doesn't get it. He does not. He can't see how people see him.
And he says.
Cleo is getting, you can tell Cleo, this is why they showed it. Cleo is just, that's where she was disassociating. She gets so frozen up as she watches.
And to me, this, what he says. They show extended footage when he says, I relish these moments when I'm alone. I'm like a wolf on the prowl. This is all an act.
Yeah.
He thinks he's having to say that because he's trying to be like a hyper sexualized masculine
but
man.
But at the same time, like the cast said, like, then what do you mean when you say wolf exactly. on the crowd? What does that mean? And he tries to blow it off and say, well, that just means I like to talk to people. No, that's not actually what wolf on the prowl means. Believe me, I do a podcast with someone who calls himself a wolf on the prowl.
But I'm saying people who talk like that and would say that, it's cartoonish. Mm-hmm. It's not real.
It's not real.
That's
yeah.
what I'm saying. What's happening is he doesn't believe after he sees it, he goes, oh, wait, they're really going to think that because that's not me. They don't know me. Mm-hmm. Because part of him has somehow separated that. Mm-hmm. But he, because anyone else who sees this goes, what an absolute douche.
Yeah.
And anyway, so y'all talking with, we find out later is Deborah, the Thanksgiving chick. Mm-hmm. So he goes, yeah,
I wrote, oh my God, Deborah's here.
It's good with me and my girlfriend. It's a few hiccups. Like, she didn't want to tell people we'd been intimate. And eventually I'd have to tell my Steiners. And she's like, what's that?
What's that?
That's a community of like-minded people. And, you know, you're a cool person. And when
you're
a Steiner.
Where'd you get the name from?
We have it's like a code word. Instead of saying, I got laid, you say, I got some Stein. You get it?
And you see her face just kind of go... It's just that it is actually the facial recognition of ew.
No, she swallowed bile.
Yeah, just ew. And then as soon as he says that, she's like, well, all right, I got to go. And he's like, do you want to come to Thanksgiving? She's like, I'm leaving the country tomorrow. Thanks.
And with that, we're going to play another version of Reality Gaze Lightning Round.
Oh, we don't have the dinger.
Christina, you can add it.
Can I have some M&Ms while we do this?
No! Then you could be your mouth's going to be full.
But it's a game. I thought it'd be fun.
No!
Well, then why did you buy the M&Ms?
The M&Ms are for later and to give us energy.
That's true.
All right. So the lightning round topic is, besides I'm going to Belgium. Mm-hmm. What are some of the other excuses that
Deborah
said not to go to Thanksgiving? Deborah. Because y'all, this woman had no plans.
No, she was staying in London.
She had nowhere to go for Thanksgiving.
She stayed at home and was going to be sad.
Yeah.
And stayed at home. And
she was grateful.
Fuck, I'm glad I'm not with that asshole.
So.
Men are idiots.
Here we go.
Okay.
I'll start you first. Instead of going to Thanksgiving dinner, Deborah said she thought about saying what?
To collect semen from dying penguins in Antarctica.
Good one.
Instead of saying she was going to Belgium, Deborah could have also said that she was going to where?
She's joining a convent.
Ding, ding, ding. Yes. Love
Instead
that.
Of going to Belgium, what could Deborah have said she's going to do on Thanksgiving?
Jump off a cliff to get away from him.
Good one.
Instead of saying she was going to go to Belgium, where could Deborah say that she was going to get away from Christian?
To have her vestigial tail removed. It's vestigial. It's just little. You can barely see
it's
it.
It's a little one.
It's at the edge. It's a very bottom of her spine.
Trigger warning if you have a vestigial tail.
Instead of going to Thanksgiving dinner, we're going to Belgium. Where did Deborah say she was going?
She's going to go to Freddie Mercury's grave to do her yearly vigil.
Oh, that's a good one.
And finally, instead of saying that she's going to Belgium, where is Deborah telling Christian she's going this year for Thanksgiving?
She's going to Italy to meet Robert Langdon to finally tell him the secret of the Mona Lisa.
Yahweh and sing.
It was a Da Vinci Code reference.
I know. That's why I sang a Catholic hymn.
Oh, you did?
Yeah. Why are they doing a play?
Remember, they're doing a play version of that? Oh, fucking Michael Urie.
I'm Robert Langdon. I'm walking around Italy looking for the Pope and all the... Oh, God. Wilson, there's all the Catholic stuff. Oh, it's all demons. Where's that guy with the weird back?
That was a terrible film.
Oh, it was not a good film. The book was good. ish.
Really?
I read it because it goes. It's one of those like. You know what I think? Anyway. It would have been better. It would have been a better television show.
Great. Anyway,
not that, a play.
That was a great lightning round.
It was a great lightning round.
Y'all, she considered all those options.
All of them. All of them.
And y'all, later on.
She's a class act. I wrote that.
Deborah?
Yes.
Yeah. So Cleo, Christian even says, is this bad? This is why there is, we're talking about dissociation before.
With him.
Yeah. This is, there's either, I'm always scared to say sociopathy, but there is a disconnect between
his nefariousness with
him. No, that's the thing.
But there's something off.
Yeah. I think it's like personality, full on personality disorder.
There's something off.
Yeah.
Deborah even watching it back, she says, yeah, watching that back and knowing now, and I know I'm like, whoa, why? She felt like he was hitting on her.
Yeah. Because there are guys who are like this, but it happens naturally. There are douchebags who are natural.
It's a bit of misogyny, too.
Oh, totally.
Because this idea of, well, I didn't. When I patted your butt, little lady, I didn't mean to make you feel uncomfortable. Right. I just wanted you to know that I appreciated you. That's where all the impetus of this starts. And the same thing of if she is watching it and her and Deborah now is saying, I feel like you were hitting on me. And he still goes, no. Bitch, she was in the room. She was in the room. You were talking to her. That is like rule 101 of how to deconstruct misogyny is men have to think about and listen when women tell them how you make them feel.
Right.
Fucking listen to that.
And even Misha says, Cleo says, him being so extroverted, I feel like I'm not enough for him. And Christian says, see, that's not true. And Misha says, but that's how she feels.
Yeah.
And it was just like.
I like Misha.
But it was like the most revelatory thing said for their situation.
Yes. Well, because she goes with that with Nicola a little bit.
Exactly.
They're both mansplainers.
Because what Christian thinks about how Cleo feels is he can say, what are you?
No, the screen.
He can say, well, she doesn't really know my heart. And it really, I know she feels that way, but that's not right. But it doesn't really matter what he thinks is right if her feelings about what is happening are completely at odds.
Yeah.
And that's what he will never fully understand.
No, because it's the empathy thing. Because empathy is what leads us as a white person going, well, I don't mean to be racist, but when I say this, people that are my black friends take it this way.
Yeah.
And change that behavior. It's not about my feelings. It's about their experience.
And it's such such a small, easy thing for me to do to not be racist.
It's so freeing, actually, because you go like, yeah, it's so not hard to do. And it's not in, I let go of my ego.
It's like the pronoun thing. It's like pronouns and saying it's such an ease for me, it's such an easy thing to say my pronouns are he and him, but some people really get upset about it.
When it's such a
small gesture that means so much to people.
But you know, we're not going to resolve this tonight. Y'all, she brings out our old good ones. But are there any plans, Christian and Cleo? And this is goes back to that performative thing. This is when Christian basically asks her to marry him.
This is a scene from a rom-com.
And what the saddest part about it to me is everyone else kind of goes, huh? Not Cleo. Because this woman is so desperate for love and validation. She literally goes, oh.
You know what it is? I just realized it.
It was really.
He's an actor. And because of her autism, it feels real to her. She can't see through it.
She can't. No. Yeah, she can't see through it. In fact, it actually probably that provides. She thinks it adds clarity.
Yes.
Y'all, they're gonna be together. I think they're gonna just get married.
Get used to it.
And he's gonna cheat on her.
I agree with you.
Yeah, He's going to 100% cheat on her.
I agree with you.
Yeah.
I think the relationship will not be a comfortable one.
No, get ready.
She will.
In 5 years, we will mark my words.
This is also.
We will see Cleo on the single life.
What I call a preposal.
It was a preposal.
This was not a proposal, but a preposal.
I love that.
This means, hey, what would you think if I asked you to get married? And then your person's like, is this a proposal? You're like, no, I'm just gauging your feelings so you won't reject me outright when I do it.
Do it.
Or, a preposal.
Or you won't also be mad at me and think about me hitting on this woman in front of millions of people.
Yes.
Because now I want to marry you.
This was one of the most disturbing things I've ever seen.
Yeah.
And how Cleo was so into it.
Come at us, psychology sissies, because I know, but it's been forever since I practiced. So if you have more experience, I'd love to hear your thoughts.
This person truly confuses me.
Yeah, he does.
Because I really do believe this is a whole personality created because he himself feels so inadequate around women, other men, mm-hmm. and he literally became this kind of combination of all little of like his friends who he thought were like hot guys and like people on the movies, people in TV.
I guarantee you, he loves Robert Redford movies.
Oh yeah, he did that. Well, I'll see you in Casablanca. Yeah. You know, it's all a hodgepodge persona. This is not official. Not official proposal.
Not official. Deborah Lee, she's a classic. My favorite is Jasmine saying, I feel very motherly about Cleo. And if this man hurts him, I will kill him.
And then they ask Jane. They're like, Jane, how are you feeling? She's like, I'm shattered. But thanks, Jane.
Thanks, Jane. Oh, Jane, sorry. Bad signal. Bye. And she just sees black screen.
Jane's saying, well, I'm shattered.
Shattered.
Because guess what, Jane? Cleo will dump you until she's having a rough time, and then you will be her Natalie.
You're
going
to be her Natalie.
You'll be her scooter girl.
You will.
And because she doesn't need you when she's in a great place.
No, she doesn't.
Yeah.
That's all I think we need to leave this here.
I think we need to leave this here.
I think we need to leave this here, y'all. That is your part one
of this
tell-all. Next
time, we'll talk about David and Sheila.
David, which had everybody crying. David and Sheila, Amanda gets her just desserts, and it is
and it's
so sweet.
And it's served up to her by her own fucking sister.
But her own fucking sister.
Ohio Kristen Stewart.
It is good.
This was beautiful.
It was beautiful. Beautiful. All right, everybody. So we're going to go take a little break, and we'll be back and for part two. Until then, go to realitygaze.com. That's where you can find everything about it. It's so pretty to do this podcast and look out at Central Park.
I know.
It's so pretty. What, are they fucking out there?
Ooh, I hope so.
I hope so. All right, everybody. So we call these people lonely hearts because aren't we all just lonely hearts looking for love in all the wrong places, poodle?
Sorry, I was dissociating.
If you know what, if you like to dissociate, then you know what you can do? You can call us.
You can call us. I feel like I dissociate every time you say
an Oklahoma story.
Back home in Molly Malone's or Murphy's. I disassociate.
Bye, y'all.